Now, local shares were lower at the end of the week. The PSE's main index shed 0.8% to close at 66.25. This was the local bourse's first weekly loss in 3 weeks after its 66.47 finish last week. Value turnover was at 2.7 billion pesos. The Fed and the ECB raising rates and an improving growth outlook for the Philippines by the International Monetary Fund. How did these affect markets today? Let's find out more from Carlos Angelo Temporal, senior equity analyst at Unicapital Securities, who now joins us on the Business Roadshow. Carlos, welcome to the program.
Yeah. Hi again, Sandy. Good to see you again.
Okay, now we had quite a lot going today, starting with growth revisions for the Philippine economy by the International Monetary Fund, pegging it now at 6.2%. We also had inflows again, which according to the BSP was mostly channeled into equities. Now, how are these priced in relative to market performance today?
Well, the IMF's revision didn't do much since the revision was mainly due to stronger than expected first quarter expansions, which in our view is already priced in along with the 1Q23 earnings outperformance of several corporates. As for BSP's hot money inflows, it's a laggard indicator and most likely has been brushed aside since the impact of foreign participation is still not being felt in the market given the low value turnovers. So right now, the market is likely focused on the earnings season, developments regarding the odds of for a September rate hike and upcoming inflation data.
Okay, so today we close almost 0.8% down from yesterday's close, but still above 6,600. What kind of correction was that, Carlos, in your view? Was that just consolidation or a bit of profit taking even from days of previous gains?
Well, yes, it's partly due to a profit taking and also as the market further digests the Fed rate hike and also some statements from Fed Chair Powell. And if we would look at the PSEI's RSI is also already approaching that 70 level. So I think some may have locked in their profits by selling up their positions. And yes, it's the movement earlier, I mean, it's still part of the of that sideways movement that we are seeing in the coming weeks.
Okay, we're looking at the chart of the Philippine Stock Index from October of last year. You've seen those lows there at 56.97. Somehow we've managed to crawl up to today's finish of above 6,600 in a painstaking crawl, if you will. Now, with prices consolidating for the most part, which still shows the market's general indecisiveness. Now, Carlos, what is the effect of long-term consolidation in our share prices?
Well, as we can see, given the dull performance of the market, this has prompted some to shift out towards other financial assets, reflective of the low average daily value turnover of the market, which for July, we estimated at around 3.8 billion per day, excluding significant block sales. And this was the lowest for more than a year. Given this, some have already parked their cash in time deposits and fixed income assets that has that were able to provide better returns for them.
Okay, Carlos, here's the thing. Growth is seen to ease for the last half of the year as high interest rates are really expected to finally bite now, and it will affect expansions. It will affect even loan portfolios, asset quality of banks, which were earlier the clear winners at the onset of the policy hiking. Now, are you still seeing banks and financials as go-to sectors for investors, or is it time to look for other counters now?
For this one, we think banks, in terms of earnings, will still do well in the next few quarters. But yes, growth will no longer be that exciting. Looking at BPI's earnings, second quarter earnings, it only ended at par with estimates, and this could be the same case for other banks. Therefore, yes, I think relative to other sectors, relative to banks, other sectors are becoming more attractive, particularly the laggards, those who will benefit from peaking interest rates and potential rate cuts next year.
Okay, now on Market Edge this morning, HSBC Head of Equity Strategy for Asia Pacific, Harold van der Linde, said the Philippine market has to prove that prices are already attractive. Well, I think we're proving that now. And that growth story has to be intact somehow to attract investors, otherwise lured by neighboring Asian markets. Now, what do you think? Isn't our growth story interesting enough?
Well, although Philippine has still has an attractive growth outlook with GDP growth of back above 6%. We note that based from GDP projections in the region, we're still coming in behind Vietnam and India. Moreover, we have this new exciting AI narrative abroad. And given this still sticky recession fears abroad, in addition to low market liquidity, and the Philippines incentives of shifting funds into Philippines is still not clear yet. Given this, I do agree with Harold that Philippine equity market needs to show firmer numbers coupled with better market activity, since I think foreign funds are now being more selective when it comes to investing in emerging markets and are no longer treating it like an investment basket.
Okay, Carlos, let's look at some of our top corporate stories now, starting off with Double Dragon, which just opened its Surigao Mall, bringing its total mall units to 45 nationwide. Here in Metro Manila, Araneta Property also embarking on expansion through a new Gateway Mall too. Now, how do you like mall expansions today, given that many existing ones are still struggling with unmaximized occupancy?
Well, similar to retailers, Pure Gold and others, that are doing now with their aggressive expansion, I think this is an ideal strategy to position ahead of the normalization of the economy, easing inflation and potential rate cuts next year. So positioning their companies as early as now would allow them to capture the likely surge in demand over that period.
Here's another one. Cemex Holdings reporting a net loss of 662 million pesos in the first half of 2023 from lower operating earnings due to higher costs of sales and challenging market conditions. Now, when are you seeing a recovery really from construction and even infrastructure, which are, well, realistically now stunted by high interest rates?
I think the resumption of the uptrend in construction and infra projects is hinged on a clearer outlook on interest rates and the rate cut timing. A lot of property developers hold on to their projects, and we're on a wait and see mode due to the unpredictability of the monetary policy over the first half of the year. So I think that's is what the management of these companies are waiting for.
All right, lastly, next week we will be embarking on trading under the ghost month. Well, is trading traditionally leaner during August? And how can this affect perhaps our market momentum, since we've been seeing quite positive gains recently?
So, well, yes, in the past few years, trading in August is mostly anemic, and this could be the same for this coming August, which also coincides with the fact that some market participants may likely wait for the next Fed's meeting in September for that clearer picture in terms of the interest rate outlook. And so I think for now, it would be just a continuation of that consolidation that we saw this July in August.
All right. Thank you so much for the insights today, Carlos Angelo Temporal of Unique Atpal Securities. Hope you could join us again soon.
Yes. Thank you again, Sandy. Thank you for having me.